the outgoing president of FICCI, Sri Pankaj Patel, the president-elect, Sri Rashish Shah, Dr. Sanjay Baru, colleagues and friends present at the annual meeting of the FICCI today. Your annual event is always an important opportunity to actually analyze what's been going on in the last 1 year. And obviously with the president-elect who has a new term to look into as to what will happen in the year to come. Last year when Sri Pankaj Patel took over, I think we stood at the cross-section of a global uncertainty. It was uncertain because the global growth itself was slow at that time. And obviously, his tenure had an opportunity to watch the curve take a turn, and this time for the better, that the global economy itself has started moving. And obviously, when the global economy does start moving, it leaves its footprints behind everywhere. And one of the important challenges which we've had in the last several years, that's the exports, is one area where, of course, the buyers, because of growing international trade, will buy more, will also give us an opportunity to utilize that situation to our own advantage. The second, of course, important change the year has seen, more particularly after the US election, has been in the developed world a renewed emphasis on protectionism. And therefore, whether it was trade policies, we've seen what happened in Buenos Aires yesterday, or it's the fiscal policies in some regimes, they seem to be impacted by this trend. I think we'll have to wait for the fine prints to see how much of an advantage it is. Because for any regime at the end of the day, its accounts have to tally. And if the accounts don't tally, then it creates a further uncertainty itself. And I'm sure the third important change which we have seen in India, and I think this is very significant, that even when the world was still in the slowdown phase and yet to take a curve for the better, India realized the importance of structural changes. And therefore, India in 2017 really has seen more structural changes taking place than any time in the recent past. And let me say this, that there's a fundamental difference between the kind of changes which took place in 1991. And now, of course, I am one of those who always welcomed the changes in 1991. But the 1991 changes were more out of compulsion. The 2017 changes were more out of conviction. And therefore, if the 2017 changes, I'm sure Dr. Baru will sometimes in the future, in his next book, use this opportunity to compare them and perhaps encourage future generations to leave, to undertake more areas which still have not been really undertaken. And I think it's extremely important that Indian society itself has shown a tremendous amount of resilience as far as structural changes is concerned. Of course, it's not easy. There has to be a lot of political determination, political decisiveness when you undertake these structural changes. There are short-term adverse consequences. A few days ago, Dr. Baru informed me that when the 1991 changes took place, the immediate result was a rapid fall in the growth rate in 1992. And from where it started picking up again, that's the impact of structural changes which takes place. In fact, the IMF at this year's annual meeting described it very crisply in a sentence where it said that it's only when the sun is shining that you decide to repair the roof. And India has utilized this opportunity. I must confess that I had thought that before, after the unified GST is implemented, it will take a reasonable amount of time when the collections move up that you will start rationalizing the tariffs. Even I had not anticipated that we'd be able to start rationalizing within a period of 3 to 4 months itself. And therefore, it's extremely important that we continue with this particular agenda of taking these structural changes, which essentially involve a greater formalization of the economy, more rationalization as far as the GST is concerned, looking at the global tax rates, and obviously therein also lies the answer to the question that Shri Patel raised. It's only when your taxation base in a formalized economy expands that your ability to rationalize the rates increases. Rationalization of rates in a non-compliant society is always more challenging and more difficult. It's only when you expand your bases, your collection basket increases, that you realize that now is the time really to rationalize the rates, and that applies equally both to direct and indirect taxes itself. I think so much as far as the economy is concerned, but there are important tasks ahead when we look at the next year. And when we look at the immediate next year, I think in addition to the areas that I've just indicated, fixing the banks and completing the unfinished task of strengthening the public sector banks, I think is unquestionably one of the most important agendas on the table today. We've already announced a detailed recapitalization plan, and the idea behind this plan is to ensure that the ability of the banks to support growth, their lending capacity, more particularly their lending capacity as far as the MSME sector is concerned, because if we want to formalize the economy, we want this sector also to be strengthened. And this strengthened sector has been at the receiving end in the last few years, particularly with the lending capacity of the banks being depleted as a result of the NPAs. And therefore, as the lending capacity of the banks because of capital adequacy is improved, the banks have a lot of money lying with them. They have a lot of low-cost deposits lying with them. But their lending ability is constrained because of capital inadequacy. And once that capital inadequacy is made up for, I think their lending capacity itself increases, and this segment has to be one of the priority areas as far as the important lending aspect is concerned. I think the other two areas is that we have to keep the momentum on infrastructure creation. India today unquestionably has one of the largest infrastructure creation programs anywhere in the world. And this infrastructure creation, if I can include even rural infrastructure in this, I think here lies the core of India's future growth story. Our highways are going on, I think we can all take a sense of satisfaction. Ports are certainly going on at a reasonable pace. The aviation sector has turned into an important success story, both in terms of airlines, also in terms of airports. And with the Udaan scheme, the present expansion which is going on, I think it's taking a further turn for the better. The railways is one area where we need to hurry up with the level of infrastructure expenditure. And therefore, our expenditure on railway infrastructure, on railway stations, on the quality of trains, on the more super-fast trains, the proposed bullet train, I think these are all areas which really need to be strengthened. Urban infrastructure. You already have about 20-odd cities in the country where you have the metro system under creation. And you can actually, if you travel across, and many of us get an opportunity to travel across various Indian cities, you can actually spot those 18 or 20 Indian cities, which in the last few years, because of quality infrastructure, have improved for the better. And therefore, that experiment has to be replicated not only on these isolated 18 or 20 cities, but on a very large number of urban centers in India, because at the end of the day, they are going to be the engines of growth itself. Water is going to be always a key issue as far as both urban and rural infrastructure is concerned. In rural areas, I think we have the daunting task of providing housing in rural areas by 2022. Sanitation. Rural roads like highways is going on at a reasonably fast pace. But as far as sanitation is concerned, it's picked up in the last 4 years after the Prime Minister's initiative. And I think over the next several years, it has to continue. And added to it, the rural housing itself. And therefore, this is going to be our main focus areas as far as expenditure is concerned. And if the state is to put in a large part of its resource, and our PPP model in many of these areas is expanded upon, I think its ability itself to push up our Indian growth rates itself is going to be extremely significant. I think India has entered a reasonable an era of reasonable political stability. And therefore, that is something which the last year itself has indicated, and I'm certainly not worried on this count itself. Politically, I think one of the important gains is the capacity of the Indian state in fighting one of our biggest challenges, terrorism, has significantly improved. And this is now evident in the central part of India. This is evident in Jammu and Kashmir. And therefore, I think the world itself has changed. The world itself does not accept terrorism. The world does not allow anybody to reap the fruits of terrorism. and the strength and the might of the state itself in fighting terrorism has significantly improved. And if we compare the situation, let's say 5 or 7 or 8 years ago, where a terrorist could pick the target at will, I think a significant credit goes to our security forces itself in having reversed that trend, in as much as they are reasonably on top as far as fighting terror is concerned. There's only one other point that I wish to raise, and I'll leave some point Mr. Patel wanted for a few questions if possible. And that's an area of concern. While decision making in India has become faster, popular support to decision making is much wider, popular support to reforms is much wider. I think the quality of discourse and the level of disruption in that discourse, I think that's also noticeably picking up. And here I would say that thoughts like ultra-left or extremism, which otherwise don't enjoy electoral support in India, I think in public discourse, they are finding a space much larger than they have in the electoral discourse. And therefore, their ability to disrupt decision-making process, or at least vitiate decision-making process, is significantly increasing. And therefore, the mainstream debates, I think, will always have to take special care as far as these areas are concerned itself. Now, once if it is not checked, the tendency to disrupt institutions, the tendency to vitiate a public discourse, the tendency to vitiate discussion on what is the roadmap to development itself, I am quite supportive of such campaigns which flag issues of poverty, because that's extremely important. Let people do that. So that when we otherwise take decisions with regard to policy, we factor in those concerns, which is quite different from disrupting the entire course and vitiating the debate itself. And I think it is this tendency which mainstream political organizations within the democratic polity itself have to check. And I think hopefully Indian democracy has the kind of resilience which can check this. I do believe that with the world now turning, it's a great opportunity for India. We have to rectify those problems as far as in the economy, which are reasonably within our reach as far as rectification itself is concerned. And if we are able to do that, I think Indian industry also has to get those instincts back in it in order to contribute to a much higher growth rate and a much higher, much prosperous India itself. Thank you very much. And I'm sure I'll be available for a brief discussion.